Okay, let's start. Our final speaker of the session is Nora, Nora Frankl, who is a, so I knew that she was a postdoc at Carnegie Mellon University, but apparently she's also affiliated with MoCCA, right, MIPT, and she'll talk on Max-Norm Ramsey theorems, which is a joint work with Andre and Arseny Sakdev.
Thank you. And also thanks, Liana, for inviting me, and thanks for Andre for organizing this nice workshop. Yes, so as Liana said already, this work I'm going to talk about was joint with Andre Kupowski and Arseny Sakdev. So I will start with a brief overview on Euclidean Ramsey theory and introducing some notions from Euclidean Ramsey theory. So the usual setup is that imagine that we have some Euclidean space of large dimension. Its points are colored, usually with a finite number of colors. And we are also given an other set, usually finite, S, and we want to find monochromatic congruent copies of this set. Okay, and then the main thing we are interested in is whether for a given set and for a given number of colors, we are always able to find these monochromatic congruent copies as long as we are allowed to choose the dimension of the space arbitrarily large. And if a set has this property, then we call it Ramsey. Okay, so a set is Ramsey if for any fixed number of colors and for this fixed shape, if the dimension is large, where this large is allowed to depend on the set itself and also on the number of colors, then no matter how this coloring is, we can always find a monochromatic congruent copy. And the big question, or the big open problem in the topic, is to decide which sets are Ramsey, which sets have this property. So it dates back to this old paper from 73. So this letters here stands for Erdős, Graham, Montgomery, Rothschild, Spencer, and Strauss. And but the problem is still very open. So let's see a little bit what is known. It's known that a pair of points is Ramsey. So it's not that obvious. It means that for any number of colors, if the dimension of the space is sufficiently large, then we can always find a pair of points at a given distance, say at a unit distance apart of the same color. Okay, but this is equivalent to the fact that the chromatic number of the Euclidean space is not bounded if the dimension grows. Okay, and then it's also known that the vertex set of non-degenerate simplices are Ramsey. Okay, and it's also known that if you have two sets that are Ramsey, you can take their product and obtain another Ramsey set. So in particular, since the pair of points is Ramsey, this implies that the vertex set of cubes or other boxes are also Ramsey. So this is also a good way to create larger Ramsey sets from smaller ones. And then it's also known that regular polytopes or the vertex set of regular polytopes or some other very symmetric sets are Ramsey. But these are more or less all the positive results. Not many other sets are known to be Ramsey. Yeah. And then there is also a negative result. So it's also known that if a set is not contained in a sphere, then there is a coloring with relatively few number of colors for any dimension in which we can't find these monochromatic congruent copies. Okay, so this gives a necessary condition for Ramseyness. And it's conjectured also to be sufficient. So this is sort of the big conjecture of the topic. And since there are only these very few type of sets that are known to be Ramsey, there is a huge set of sets that are conjectured to be Ramsey, but not known whether they are Ramsey. And also for a while, this was really the conjecture in the topic until relatively recently, when an alternative conjecture was proposed, according to which it's only the subtransitive sets are Ramsey. So a set is transitive if its symmetric group acts transitively on the set. and it's subtransitive if it's a subset of a transitive set. Okay, but this transitive set of which the subtransitive is a subset of can be of higher dimension, of arbitrarily high dimension. And because of that, it's not very easy to decide which sets are subtransitive. And in particular, for a while, it was not clear whether these two conjectures are really different. Okay, it was not clear if the sets of sets that are conjectured to be Ramsey by these two are different. Okay, but now at least that is known. Now it's known that there are examples of spherical sets that are not subtransitive. Okay, but it's still not known whether those sets are Ramsey or not. According to the first conjecture, they are Ramsey. According to the second conjecture, they are not. Okay, so some other related notions. Imagine again that now we color the points of some higher dimensional Euclidean space with a number of colors. And we want to do it in a way that points at unit distance apart get a different color. Okay, and the smallest number of colors with which we can do this is the chromatic number of the n-dimensional Euclidean space. Or we can also introduce a bit more general notion. We can introduce this chromatic number with respect to a set. Okay, so analogously. Okay, so chromatic number with respect to some set S, usually finite, is the smallest number of colors that we need to color in a way that we avoid all monochromatic congruent copies of this set. So a few things are also known about this chromatic number. So that the classical easy to get bounds for the chromatic number of the plane were 4 and 7. These are sort of trivial bounds, and they were all bounds, not very odd bounds, not improved for a long time, until very recently when this lower bound was improved to 5. And then there are also non-trivial upper and lower bounds in 3 dimension and some other small dimension. And for larger n, there are exponential upper and lower bounds known. Okay, so proving an exponential lower bound is not easy at all. It was first done by Frankl and Wilson with a bit worse space here. Those proofs usually use, for getting exponential lower bounds, these proofs usually use extremal set theory results. And but this 1.2 is the current best space. And to obtain exponential upper bound, the usual way is to take some large periodic subset that will correspond to one color and try to cover the space, the whole space with relatively few copies of this large periodic set. Okay, and for example, it's also known that there are also exponential lower bounds for the chromatic number with respect to vertex set of, say, simplices or boxes. Okay, so this is something stronger than just being Ramsey, right? So in particular, this implies that they are Ramsey. So it's good to keep in mind that there is an equivalent definition of Ramseyness. So equivalent definition is that the set is Ramsey exactly if the chromatic number with respect to that set is not bounded. They are really trivially equivalent. Okay, so, and because of that, because deciding if a set is Ramsey or not is very difficult, because of that, proving good lower bounds on the chromatic number is also very difficult. Okay, one more set. Right. So let me move to some other norms. We can define these chromatic numbers analogously, say, for LP norms. Okay, so the chromatic number of the n-dimensional space with the LP norm is analogously the smallest number of colors. If you want to color the points in a way that points at distance 1 apart according to the LP norm get different colors. And of course, we could also define it analogously with respect to some sets. And there are also exponential upper and lower bounds known for this. But I would mainly like to focus on the max norm. So many many combinatorial geometric question becomes very easy or almost trivial if we move from the Euclidean to the max norm. But with these Ramsey things, we have a very fortunate situation when many problems become more accessible, but yet they remain very interesting. So just to warm up to this max norm setting, let's see quickly that we can tell the chromatic number exactly. So the simple chromatic number. So it's exactly 2 to the n. This is sort of a floor statement, but let's see the proof quickly to warm up. To see that we need at least 2 to the n color, we can take the vertex set of a cube, right? Or you can imagine taking all the points with 0, 1 coordinates. Then with the max norm, the distance between any of these 2 is 1. So any 2 of these points must get a different color, showing that we need at least 2 to the n colors. And from the other side, this is enough because we can find a tiling kind of coloring. So we can tile the whole space with unit cubes, and within each cube, we color with the same color. And then if we arrange cubes of the same color carefully, then cubes of the same color will be sufficiently far so that there are no unit distance between them. We only have to be a bit careful with the boundary of the cube, but that's not a big issue. So the more general situation with Ramsey things, finding chromatic numbers with respect to other sets, it's not this easy, but there are some nice and interesting things going on. So before discussing more details of this max norm setup, let me move a little bit to a more general setting. So imagine now that we just have 2 metric spaces, say X and Y, and now imagine that the points of X are colored, and we are looking for isometric copies of this other metric space. So a subset of the first metric space that are colored is an isometric copy of this other metric space Y if there is a distance preserving bijection between them. And for us, usually X will be some high dimensional space with a maximum, and Y will be a finite metric space. And then here is an illustration of how these isometric copies might look like. So in this picture, my Y will be this finite metric space on 4 points with a metric induced from the real line. So the distances here are really just what you see. And then X now is the plane with the max norm. And then this red set is an isometric copy of the blue one. Right, you can check pairwise distances. For example, between these 2, the distance is the difference between the X coordinates is 2, difference between the Y coordinates is 1. So we have maximum distance 2 here, and you can check it similarly for all the other points. Okay, and then we can generalize our chromatic number notion and define a chromatic number of the metric space X with respect to this forbidden metric space Y to be the smallest number of colors that we need if we want to color in a way that we avoid all isometric monochromatic copies of Y. And well, to define Ramseyness, we need a sequence of spaces. So I just stick with the LP norms. So then we can define some metric space, usually finite, to be Ramsey, if the chromatic number of this LP spaces of this n-dimensional spaces with the LP norm tend to infinity. And well, here I allow P to be, I allow this LP norm to be actually the max norm, and then we get this analogous notion for Ramseyness of sets of metric spaces with a max norm. And but then a very nice fact, a very nice result that Andrei and Arseny proved before I joined them is that every metric space is Ramsey with this natural generalized notion of Ramseyness with the max norm. Okay, so the situation is very, very different than the Euclidean case. In the Euclidean case, deciding which sets are Ramsey is very difficult, and there are also many sets that are not Ramsey. And here the situation is completely different. Right? Every set is just Ramsey. So in particular here, we have a characterization, if you like to put it that way. So I would like to sketch very, very briefly in a very compact way the proof of this result so that the rest of the things I'm going to say make more sense. Okay, the building blocks of the proof are what we call patterns. Okay, these are just these simple finite metric spaces that can be embedded on a real line. Okay, so set of points on a line with a metric induced from the real line. Okay, so for example, B, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 is this four-point set. So we decode these patterns with the gaps between consecutive points. And then B, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 is this four-point set or a metric space isometric to it. Okay, where, say, the distance between the first and the second point is alpha 1, and the distance between the second, the third is alpha 2, then the distance here is alpha 1 plus alpha 2, and so on and so on. And just if you recall this example of an isometry that I showed before with these red and blue points, isometric copies of this might look in some sense very different than this. So you can always move around them a little bit and find isometric copies of this with the max norm that are very far from being collinear. Okay, so the first step of the proof is to show that these simple metric spaces are Ramsey. And this is the most crucial and difficult part of the proof. So this is the real work. And then second step is to prove that product of Ramsey metric spaces is Ramsey. This is sort of an analogous statement of the Euclidean version. And in particular, what we obtain that since we know already that buttons are Ramsey, what we obtain is that the product of buttons is also Ramsey, which look like grid kind of structures. And then the last two steps are simple. So third step is to show that every subset with the metric induced from the max norm of this higher dimensional spaces with the max norm can be embedded in a grid of which we already know are Ramsey. So this already shows that those metric spaces that can be realized with the max norm are Ramsey. Okay, and then if you want to go one step further, let's just show that any finite metric space is Ramsey. We only need this, I think, well-known fact that every finite metric space can be embedded in a sufficiently large dimensional space with the max norm. Okay. So as the whole proof really builds on these patterns, they are particularly interesting. So I will focus on this in the rest of the talk, proving some sharp bounds on the chromatic number of these metric spaces for the case of integers, right, when these distance gaps are integers. So Andrei and Arseny proved actually something a little stronger than just proving that every metric space is Ramsey. So they proved that there is even exponential overbound, which is a bit stronger than just being Ramsey. But they also proved some exponential upper bounds. So some exponential upper bound we already have just from the fact that the simple chromatic number is exponential, but they proved something better than those that are also specific for the given metric space. Okay, and then for some specific batons, they also got the correct base. Okay, one specific case for which they got this correct space, correct base is a baton that is given by k equally spaced points on the real line. And they also proved some more specific exponential upper and lower bounds for the case of three-term batons. Okay, so this B alpha one is the baton that consists of 3 points. The distance between the first 2 points is one. Distance between the second and the third is alpha. Okay, but for some alphas, these bounds are good, but for example, they get a bit far if alpha is large. So if alpha is large, then this one is close to one and this one is close to two. Okay, and what I will discuss in the next couple of slides is that we can get the exact basis for all integer patterns, not only for the specific ones. So integer buttons, again, are those where these distances are all integers between the points, and we will find exact bases. So just to state our result, I need to introduce some other notions, okay, a one-dimensional notion. So this density, is the density of the densest subset of the integers that doesn't contain a copy, a translate, or a reflected copy of our baton. So for example, if our baton consists only of 2 points, then this density is 1/2. Okay, that's easy to see. Okay, it's also not hard to see that if we have an equally spaced triple, then the density corresponding to that, this optimal density, is 2/3. Yeah, and our result is that the chromatic number of these integer batons can be related very well to this one-dimensional density. Okay, the basis is the reciprocal of this one-dimensional density. So Andrei Andersen had this result for some specific integer batons, and then their proof ideas could be extended to get exact or just better bases, sharper bases for other integer batons, but the proofs were always very specific for the given baton. They always had to be adjusted, and this adjustment was not always smooth. And for some batons, it was just too difficult to do or led to a too big case analysis. And what is new in our proof is that it handles just all batons at once in a general way, also in a short and compact way. So I need one more notion, sort of a finite version of this density. Okay, so this independence number is the size of a larger set that we can select, we can pick from some finite subset of the integers or of some integer lattice without containing a copy of our baton. Okay, again, containing a copy in this isometric sense. Okay, so X for us will usually be a cube. The integer points in a cube. And so the key of the proof is to prove that this independence number behaves very nicely when we take products. Okay, so let me see first quickly, just very briefly, how to get the proof of the whole statement. Once we have the key lemma, So we use the key lemma in the lower bound. Okay, I really don't want to spend too much time on it. This step here is just pigeonholing. Okay, and then in this step we use the key lemma. Okay, and the upper bound is a standard technique. Again, we just find some large B-free set and periodic one, and we cover the whole space with relatively few copies of that. Each copy will correspond to one color. Okay, and I just would like to give details of the proof of this key lemma. So what's this key lemma again exactly? It says that if we take we take some subset of the integers, okay, you can think of just an interval, okay? And if we take the nth power of this subset, then the independence number of that one is exactly the independence number, the nth power of the independence number of the one-dimensional thing. Okay, and so seeing that this side, the left-hand side, is at least as large as the right-hand side, that's the easy direction, because once we have some B-free set in this part, we can again take its nth power, and it's easy to check that will be a B-free set here. So the main thing is upper bounding this quantity. Okay, this higher dimensional independence number. Okay, so what we do? I will take a large some large B-free subset, and I will upper bound its size in terms of this one-dimensional independence number. Okay, and we want to do it in an inductive way, also with some pigeonholing. And for that, somehow we need to get a good way of capturing what does it mean that something behaves like some subset behaves like a one-dimensional thing. Okay, and we capture this thing through putting a partial ordering on the elements of this power set. Okay, and I define this partial ordering so that two points are comparable if the distance between them is taken along the last coordinate. And this will be very helpful. And we will then upper bound the size of every chain. So I have an illustration. So in the partial ordering, for example, then these two points are comparable because the distance between these two is taken along the y-axis. Okay. And actually what I get here is a chain. Okay. You can check that the distance between any two is taken along the y-axis. Okay. And this chain then is like a one-dimensional thing. Okay, so we can project it on the y-axis. That's an isometry because all distances were taken along the y-axis, and it's also a bijection because if two points would project to the same point, then the distance between them would be taken along the x-axis. Okay, and since our original set was B-free, then this projection, this one-dimensional thing, is also B-free. So it's at most as large as this independence number. And with a similar projecting argument, but now projecting on the plane that corresponds to the first n minus one coordinates, we can also, together with induction, we can similarly bound the size of antichains. And then if you put these two things together, then with Dilworth theorem, we just got what we wanted. Okay. So I think I'm running very short on time. So I wanted to speak a little bit just about this one-dimensional quantity, this one-dimensional densities, because they are a lot more interesting than they appear just for first. So for example, we got this result now we can tell what is the base for these chromatic numbers, but it's not clear a priori, what did we get exactly? So you know, if we can actually determine these densities. And the answer in some sense is that we can determine them because it can be proven that these optimal densities for any baton is always achieved on some periodic set with bounded period. And then because of that, they can be computed. But telling them explicitly only based on the gap sequences is very difficult. Okay, and then, but there is a lot of work related to this. I think I'm going to skip a lot of things.
It can take some time, it's fine. We have, we have 3 more minutes for questions, but there's another 5 minutes, so you can take your time.
Okay, so yeah, I will tell just a few more things. So just cut these things short. There are really a lot of interesting things. And one thing that we managed to do, which is already can get surprisingly complicated, is to get these optimal densities explicitly for 3-term batons, okay, in terms of the gap sequences. So if we have some 3-term thing with the difference between the first two lambda, difference between the second two, lambda one, lambda two, okay, then, well, there was a conjecture for the exact optimal densities for this, and but we managed to prove that. So it's always very, very close to 2/3. And kind of then the difficult part is to tell how close is it actually. And it depends also on the mod 3 values of these gaps. And well, in particular, this gives that for the chromatic number of these patterns, we can't only tell that it's possible to compute these pieces, but we can tell them explicitly. And let me just finish with one more curious fact. Okay, so far I spoke about mostly finite sets. Okay, and just in the Euclidean setting, it's also known that Ramsey sets must be finite. Okay, it's very quick to see for non-bounded set, but it's not that obvious for bounded infinite sets, but it's also true that bounded infinite sets are not Ramsey either. And surprisingly, this is not true in the maximum setting. So we have now examples of infinite sets that are Ramsey with the maximum. And I think I finish now. Thank you for listening. And I'm also, I think, the last speaker. So I thank you again, Diana, for organizing this session.
Thank you, Nora. First, let's thank Nora for the wonderful talk. Any questions?
Well, I guess I could have asked some, but it doesn't make any sense because I'm a co-author, so yeah.
Why not? I think it's the best if the co-authors challenge.
Well, okay.
By my co-authors' questions. Like, now it will be clear who did what.
Yeah, and after you said that, then no one will ask.
Okay, it's a joke.
I mean, I can ask about this, the infinite, infinite sets. What about the upper bounds on this, possible upper bounds on this chromatic number for infinite sets? And in general, what is the situation?
So it's at most linear, right? So if there are at least in D plus one colors, then we can prevent appearing any infinite set.
Well, I can also add a comment that in this case we can, it's funny because if we change the quantifiers, that for every D we can show that there is a set which needs D plus one colors. Or for every N we show that there is an infinite set that needs N plus one colors. But if we want the same set for all dimensions, that's only this log that we can show. And that's a very interesting open problem, I think.
I have a question. Hi, Nora. Is there anything known for fractional chromatic numbers of R to the N and stuff like that? Like for all these problems? It's not, so the chromatic number is greater than the fractional chromatic number. So let's say for the Euclidean space, I believe this Frankl-Wilson construction, well, it doesn't work trivially, but I think it's still satisfied. They still grow exponentially large because I think the fractional chromatic number is still at least the number of vertices in the graph over the size of the largest independent set. But is there anything about upper bounds that's non-trivial or about any of these other problems for simplices or?
Sorry, I'm not sure about that. Andre, do you know?
Well, my feeling is that, so the thing that happens is that when you pass from this ratio of number of vertices divided by alpha to the chromatic number, then you typically get this extra factor of D or D log D because you use the covering methods. And so this is what you get. And my feeling is that you can basically get rid of it if you deal with the fractional chromatic number, because this is, I think, like, for example, this Raman Prasanov's approach that Nora mentioned, Roma Prasanov in one of the slides. I think that what he does is essentially... it's Nasodi approach. Yes, Nasodi approach applied to, by Roma to this problem. I think that what he does is he works with the fractional version, and how it's done, you work with the fractional version and you get essentially optimal. And then you pass to the integral version using this Lovas relation between fractional coverings and integral coverings. So I think that, I've never really thought about much about it or at all, but I think that you can get essentially tight bounds.
Yeah. Thank you. I'll look into this. I don't know the paper.